First of all, before I start, I wanted to say thank you to the British Council for inviting me to speak to you today, and also to the Immigrant Council, who I think are partners for this evening. It's a real privilege to be able to come and talk to you about the voice of women, and especially about the voices of Muslim women today. And actually, on my way here from London, on the flight, I was very pleasantly surprised to hear that the captain of the aeroplane was a woman, which I don't know if you have ever heard the captain announced as a woman, but is quite an unusual thing to happen. And subsequently, after I landed here, I found that about 5 to 7% of all pilots globally are women, only 5 to 7%. And apparently there's only about 500 captains that are female anywhere in the world. So I went to speak to the captain and congratulate her and ask if I could take a photo of her to include in my deck today to show you. But she did what all women do and said, no, I couldn't possibly, I'm too shy to share my face with other women. And then she went, and I don't look very good right now, I need to brush my hair. And it's very telling of women that their amazing achievements are taken very modestly. But actually I took that as an extremely good omen for coming this evening, that I had this female captain. So a voice whether written, spoken or typed, requires belief that you have something important to say. And Muslim women, all women, have something critical to say at this time in history, in society where culture, politics, geography and technology bring us closer together and more intertwined than ever before. The clear voice is the one that has a vision to communicate. And Muslim women across time and place have done that, and they continue to do so. From the famous Sufi Rabia al-Adawiya to the unexpected women's rights activist in partition India, Sultana Begum, who I'll talk about later, who wrote a very famous scientific utopia called Ladyland. There are Muslim women in history and today who are leading change in communities, in cultural and religious understanding. As a whole, women's voices have been lost across all cultures and religions, but we are all reclaiming our voices, their power and their importance, and we're using them fearlessly. And in this revival of women's voices come Muslim women's voices too. And Muslim women have a vital role to play in today's cultural and political and civic spheres. And that comes with prickly challenges from both within the Muslim community and from wider societies that we are part of. There are stereotypes that tell Muslim women how they should look, how they should think, how they should act, and of course, what they should say. But among the many rights of a Muslim woman is that she can and must say exactly as she chooses. It is her voice, her mind, her brilliance that should be conveyed. And our society as a whole, our global society, needs that Muslim voice. And one of the most powerful voices in building shared cultures is speaking up and speaking out. But more important even than that is speaking with others. And this can only be done when we individually and as groups feel confident in our voices and feel confident in sharing our ideas. And so today what I want to do is talk to you about some of the context from within which Muslim women speak, and actually some of the voices of Muslim women that are out there already. I don't have, you know, the whole day to talk to you, so necessarily it's going to be a bit of a broad brush just for us to have some food for thought. But opening this conversation is absolutely crucial. And many of you will know that in Islamic tradition, there is a race, there's a competition to see who can be the first to open a conversation. You will have heard Muslims open with the phrase, Salam alaikum. And actually, the traditions from the Prophet say that all of the blessings are for the person who opened the conversation. And once somebody has actually opened, it is obligatory. You have to respond. And that is the beginning of the conversation. Now, there's only really one thing that I want us to go away with, and particularly to emphasize about women and Muslim women in this talk today. And that's the idea that women are often taken to be behind the scenes, that somehow a woman's place is a little bit further back from the forefront. And that's true in whatever cultures we have. When you look at the statistics of women in positions of politics and influence and power and commerce, The numbers are much lower for women than they are for men. And what a lot of women are slowly starting to realise, but my story about the captain is one of those stories, is that we have power available to us. The power to change ourselves and the power to change those around us. And the most powerful tool to do that is the voice. And we often overlook our voices. This is true for men and women. We overlook the power that we have of our voice. Sometimes we don't realize it, sometimes we misuse it, or even we waste it away. And our voice is one of the most incredible things that we have to share with those around us. And if you think about how amazing our voices are, everyone has a unique voice. And the obvious meaning of that is that the sound of it is unique. And it's incredible that even, for example, my two-year-old can tell somebody from the phone because of their individual voice. But that voice is not just the sound, it's not the auditory qualities, it's also what that person is saying, what we are saying, what I am saying. Each person has a unique thing to say. Our voices are beautiful. They capture attention, they generate emotion, they can change people's minds. And if we think about the way that words across history have changed society, have changed the course of history, here are just two examples of somebody who's used a phrase that has created a social shift. I don't know if you agree or disagree with them, but there's no denying that these kind of voices have had a huge amount of power to change the way we think about ideas in society. Other ones you might be familiar with is the Quran's first word was ikra, read, and it signaled a change, a shift in the way that that culture should be heading and the importance of thinking, reading, abstract ideas and communication. If we think about Gandhi, he used the notion of non-violent resistance. Again, a phrase, a voice that changed a nation. He didn't do it on his own, but it captured the spirit of what people were talking about. And even if we talk about George W. Bush and his phrase, you're either with us or you're with the terrorists. Again, it was a statement, a voice that changed the way that people approached a particular idea. So the way that we use our voices is incredibly powerful, and small phrases can have an incredible impact. And that voice connects us to the world around us. But of course, I'm not talking about just the sound of your voice. The voice is something more than that. It can be standing on a platform like I am today, or it can mean outside, writing. It can mean having a conversation with the people next to you. It can mean just reinterpreting something that somebody has told you. It can be being part of an organization. It can mean being part of a committee. There are many ways and many interpretations of what voice is, but it's about getting your idea, your perspective, and your energy into the world around you so that you can change it. And so I wanted to give that context because the voice partly is so powerful that we forget how it can and should be used. And one of the things I'm hoping we'll go away with is a sense that our voices, each of us in this room, has a really important voice, and that can be used to go out and change the societies we live in. And it can be as simple as going home and telling somebody something that you heard that changed your mind. And I think it's really important in a discussion about the way that Muslim women's voices are flourishing, that we understand how powerful even the smallest voices can be. And so some of the examples that I'll go through are not, you know, famous women. They're not the Hillary Clintons of the Muslim world. They're actually women who, from the ground up, are making that change with their voices. So the first thing that I wanted to go through before I talk about some of the women is, what does it feel like to be a Muslim woman? And to look at some of the context within which Muslim women are raising their voices. Now, I should apologize that these examples are UK-centric, but hopefully they'll be familiar enough with you. And even if they're not, you might go, which will be good enough for me. So a little experiment which I like to run every so often is to go to Google Images and see what does a Muslim woman look like. And this is the first page that came up. It's a bit depressing, frankly. There's a lot of black, a lot of cover faces that are covered up. I only appear in there because I write about Muslim women so much that the search brings up my algorithm. And what was even more depressing was I was looking back at one I'd done about 2 years ago, and it was almost identical, which makes me feel very sad that not that much has changed. So I just want to, when, as a Muslim or somebody who's not Muslim, if you're looking at the papers, this is the kind of context that you feel that you're within. This was a plot just before the Olympics, 2010, when the preparations were being done and the Pope was visiting. And there were two cleaners were overheard chatting about something and immediately arrested because apparently they were plotting to kill the Pope. So that's a pretty depressing newspaper to come to wake up to in the morning. And there was an apology and there was a correction to the story, but that was on page 9 in like really little writing. And there's a sense that if a Muslim does something wrong, then the entire population is held accountable for it. And this becomes particularly true of Muslim women. So this was a story in the UK where some soldiers had returned from Afghanistan and Muslims, about 30 Muslims in a population of 2.8 million, had gone to the town where they had returned to protest. And of course, we have a picture of Muslim women, obviously, because they're to blame for everything. And yet the reverse is not held true. So rightly, if I don't know if you remember this story of the pastor in the US where he decided to burn a Quran and bring the entire clash of civilizations to a head, as far as I could tell. He was only held solely responsible, which is how it should be. And yet if you're a Muslim, it may feel like there's some kind of double standards going on. There's a burden on your shoulders to kind of correct all of the perceptions of society. And women already, whether they're Muslim or not, have that kind of additional burden to kind of take on the ills of society. One of the things I find really interesting when you've started to look at those kind of images, and you will have seen many of them, is there's a sense that you just become powerless in your own story. I mean, how many times can you write to the newspapers and say, you know, please, please, please stop putting pictures of women in veils on the front when the story has nothing to do with them? Or when all you see is this kind of neutral, non-visual impression of Muslim women. Or, you know, for example, this was a story of a girl in Afghanistan and what happened to her. And these are the images that you see of Muslim women when, particularly one like the one on my right, is totally irrelevant to the story. And I think the owners of media have a real responsibility, if they want to stop Muslim women being anonymous, to stop making Muslim women anonymous. It's as really as obvious and simple as that. So this sense of powerlessness needs to be overcome. And I think that's why a lot of the women that we'll look at are so impressive. Susan was kind enough to mention Femin, who were a radical feminist group, and they say that they're going to save Muslim women because Muslim women can't think for themselves and they are slaves, and I quote, by declaring International Topless Jihad Day. And to me, that just shows there's a disrespect for Muslim women. Actually, a lot of women generally oppose this as well, but in particular, it's not helpful to call the people you're trying to liberate slaves. There's a certain sense of irony, which I can joke with you about later. But that is part of the discourse. And one of the problems that Muslim women face, and women generally face, is that if they do try to speak up, there's a huge worry about reputation, about sort of putting your head above the parapet. And this is Malala Yousafzai, who you will have heard of got shot by the Taliban for exactly the kind of putting your head above the parapet in fighting for women's education. And this is a pretty brutal example of what happens to you and your reputation. But I think that this is a very physical example, but a lot of women worry about their own reputation if they are going to speak up and speak out. So that's a real worry for women. And the last thing that I just wanted to talk about is that when women, Muslim women, do try to express in a way that is accessible to society, there seems to be this constant kind of talking at cross purposes. So there is a will to engage by everybody, but somehow there is no connection. And I think this is one of the areas that a lot of work needs to be done in. It's how do you get two people, two groups, or multiple groups who are actually willing to engage and trying, but somehow can't find the language to connect. And these are some really good examples. So there have been multiple issues around cartoons being published that you'll be familiar with. And on the one hand, people say, well, it's freedom of expression. We should be able to publish these cartoons. And Muslims saying, well, yes, but there's already a great deal of prejudice against Muslims. Maybe this is something you might want to reconsider. You know, a lot of Muslims say, well, my mom said, if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything nice at all. They're both legitimate positions, and the question is, how do you come to a dialogue rather than making people go further apart? And I think Muslim women feel that in particular. This was a case in Switzerland, I think probably a couple of years ago now. Again, I don't know if you're familiar with it. There was a lobbying by government to pass legislation to make minarets illegal. So you can see on the picture just above me. So minarets like that would be illegal, but church spires like that one would not be illegal. And the poster used by those who are running the campaign against the minarets had, guess what, a picture of a Muslim woman in a black veil in it, even though she was nothing to do with the entire campaign. And so I'm trying to kind of create a mosaic of the context within which these women are operating and the kind of feelings it engenders in being able to speak out. And perhaps most relevant to Muslim women, I've picked out the niqab here, but you can tell the same story for the headscarf in the way that I wear it or any other kind of form of veiling. Is, you know, is this a form of imprisonment for women, or is it something that Muslim women choose for themselves and think is part of their adornment? Again, how do you kind of create that conversation in a way that both people can feel that it's expressing what they feel about it? I won't read you all these stats. These are from a survey in the UK about, essentially it says, people feel pretty negative. And again, this will weigh disproportionately on Muslim women. More negativity. And just in case you missed my message so far about how negatively Muslims and Muslim women can feel, here are some delightful headlines from the front pages of some of the British newspapers. So that's the context within which Muslims feel themselves. And as I've pointed out, Muslim women's imagery and discussion seems to be at the forefront of that. So when we talk about Muslim women raising their voices, it's actually quite an achievement, even when they're at this kind of growing level. So this is the bit that we want to talk about, right? So if you go back to Google and you then put in British Muslim women, so I've kind of made it a bit more granular, actually the type of stories that we start to see are different. So that generic Muslim woman, blackness, oppression, you know, slightly depressing look has started to become humanized. We've got a football team, we've got some women in politics, you know, there's all sorts of things going on. And this is a really important lesson for both for Muslim women, women in general, and anyone who's doing work in this space, which is as soon as you humanize the story, you have a personal touch in it. You've got an activity like football that other people can relate to. That kind of wall comes down and people can start to engage in a more human fashion. This is, that didn't work, did it? Okay, I did have an Irish Muslim woman one and it looked really nice, but that's not it, sorry. I'm sorry, I did have it and I've obviously forgotten to put it in. But yes, again, the Irish Muslim women, this is your homework. You can go away and have a look at Google. It's quite a nice picture. You know, there's all sorts of diversity and variety in it. And in terms of the way Muslim women's trends are changing, there's a lot of developments that are allowing Muslim women's voices to be more heard. So there's greater levels of education for Muslim women right across the world. More Muslim women are getting married later, which has huge benefits in terms of acquiring education, having better marriages. As Susan was saying, that improves their survival rates for pregnancy and their outcomes. It also means interesting things for from a commercial perspective, which is women have more disposable income, which means they can spend more and they're driving businesses to do more interesting things tailored specifically for Muslim women, which is quite exciting. I'll talk about that later. And it also means that education is driving Muslim women to be in greater positions of power and influence because they've had the opportunity to engage more in the civic space. And the other huge trend, which won't be a surprise to you, is around the development of social media and the internet. Because some of the traditional barriers to Muslim women raising their voices are, can they get physical access to the place where they need to be? And the internet takes some of those barriers away. It gives access to information, resources, to influencers. And it also, particularly in countries where there's a more tribal or class structure, allows women to interact with people they wouldn't normally come across. So it's actually a really, really powerful tool that it's been for women. I'm not going to dwell on this. This is just to say there's a lot of complexity to Muslim women, and we can come back and maybe talk about this later at the end. But I was looking at three spheres of Muslim women's life. How important is family to her, and how is she changing that? How important is her faith? And actually, there's a revival across many Muslim women who are finding that their faith is actually the thing that helps them to shape their identity, and is a really core component of that. And also modern life. Muslim women, possibly more than a lot of Muslim men as minority populations, are actually driving that integration process because they are embracing education, they're embracing being part of society in a way that a lot of Muslim men are not. So maybe we'll come back and talk about that later. So I wanted to have a look at some of the Muslim women who are actually raising their voices. And when I chose the title Pioneers and Proclaimers, what I wanted to convey is that these are women who are actually on the cutting edge of change. They are radically altering the way that women participate in not just the Muslim community, but in the wider world, but also are changing the way that all of us think about the wider world. And while it's important that Muslim women are changing the world for Muslim women, it's actually even more exciting that they're changing the world for everybody. And I think that's why their voices are so interesting. So on the far side from me is Yasmin Mugahid. And she is, she's not a theologian, but she writes a lot about spiritual reclamation, about how you connect with your inner core, compared to some, you know, being in the rat race. And she has a huge following. She's very popular. She's published a book, very softly spoken, lovely, but almost like a kind of a life coach for being Muslim, which is in a way a slightly sort of new age version of being a Muslim preacher. But she's female, which is you know, quite unusual. In the middle is somebody who I think could be classed as a theologian called Amina Wadud. And she's most famous for her first book. She's a British, she's an American black Muslim woman. So she's at the intersection of all the difficulties that you could possibly face. And yet she's a very powerful speaker. Her first most acclaimed book is called Woman and Quran. And she goes back to the Quran to look at the scripture to see how can and should women's role be reinterpreted. So she's very exciting. She's a little bit controversial, as you would expect, but very interesting to watch. And closest to me is a German Muslim called Sheikha Halima Krausen. And again, she has a lot of women and men go to her for spiritual guidance. And because she's European, there's a sense that she kind of understands what it's like to be a Muslim living in Europe. So these are three really interesting women in the area of theology and spirituality. Very excitingly is literature. And I think what's really good about literature, and particularly some of these authors, is that these are mainstream writings by Muslim women. They're not written by Muslim women only for Muslim women. So if I explain what I mean, in the top left is an author called Leila Abu Leila. I don't know how many of you have heard of her. She's half Sudanese, half Egyptian, lives in Qatar, but spent a lot of time in Britain, and has actually been shortlisted for a number of awards in the UK for her works, which include another book called Minaret. So she writes mainstream books that are extremely popular, extremely well received, and you would find in your ordinary bookshop. In the bottom, we've got an English Muslim woman who's married to an Algerian Berber called Wendy Madour, who writes children's books. And if you have children, I really recommend them. They're very good fun. And her latest book was called A Hen in a Wardrobe, which is a story of how a child, they go visiting their family in Algeria and how they discover their heritage. But it's aimed at a mainstream audience. It so happens that the characters in it are Muslim. And she says that she gets really excited when people review it and say, I love the story. It was only at the end I noticed that they were Muslim, which may sound a kind of aside, but actually is really important in the way that we start to understand Muslims as part of a diverse audience. And I think a lot of Muslims who are activists will say that we long for the day when you switch the TV on and it's a news program, the Muslim isn't there because it's a Muslim issue, the Muslim's there because it's some totally random subject and they just happen to be Muslim, but they're an expert in the subject on there. And I think that's what a lot of this writing is moving towards. In the top right, we've got an author called Naima B. Roberts. So she wears a face veil. She writes teen fiction, most famously this book. That doesn't look very good, does it? That's not a book. And in the bottom is a Lebanese-Australian author, some of you may be familiar with, called Randa Abdel Fattah. And she writes, again, teen fiction. And her most famous book is Does My Head Look Big in This?, which is a kind of coming-of-age story of a Muslim teen and her angst about boys and what she should wear and whether she should wear a headscarf. And she's about to publish this book called No Sex in the City. And it's not dodgy, so you can read it with your family, it's fine. So there's so many more authors that I could pull out, but these are some of the ones that I think are really interesting. Again, in arts and media, this is not a sphere that we normally hear about Muslim women. But these are some of the interesting ones. So on the far side, there was a project done by the the International Museum of Women in the US, and they've run a project called Muslima, which is about art by Muslim women. And this is one of the images which I thought was quite striking, which I quite like. So you can find that online, and the entire gallery is available. So that's art and stories by Muslim women themselves. In the middle, I feel like I should be testing you because you've gone all a bit quiet. Anyone in the middle? That's Muna Abu Suleiman. So she is a Saudi woman who hosts her own TV show. She has a huge Twitter following of, I think, about 110,000, which in the Middle East is, you know, quite sizable. She's also the Secretary General of the Prince Walid bin Talal Foundation. She's extremely influential, but, you know, seems very approachable, very open. I think she's just opened her own fashion line as well. So she's somebody who's got a huge amount of influence across women, particularly in the Middle East. And the final one is a very interesting story. So I can never pronounce her name. It's, and don't tell me later if I got it wrong. It's Ineka Kesherawati. She's Indonesian. And she was, I'm not sure how, I think she's normally called, she used to be a hot film star. And then she decided that she wanted to become more practicing. So in full view of the 300 million Indonesian public, she started to become more practicing and wear a veil. So she's got quite a following amongst the more practicing Muslim women, in younger Muslim women in Indonesia. And she's now the brand ambassador for a halal cosmetics company. So there are some really interesting stories about what these women are doing. There's also one, actually, I should mention, a Malaysian pop singer called Yuna, who also wears a veil and has been signed by an international label, I forget which one, and who also has millions of Twitter followers because she's out in the public space singing. She's got a very beautiful voice. She's a really famous pop star and is starting to tour globally as well, so that might be one to look out for. Business. Now, one of the areas I think that's always overlooked when we talk particularly about Muslim women's voices is the area of commerce, because it's very easy to talk about women who are active in, you know, the political sphere or changing social cultures, all of which are really important. But I think one of the most unsung ways to create change is through business. And I think some of these examples are really interesting, partly because women are showing that as soon as they're given a little bit of opportunity to be entrepreneurial, they grab it. And they're developing a lot of new products specifically for themselves, born out of their own desire, but then serving others. So if we start off with the one next to her, that's a British Muslim woman who converted to becoming Muslim. She's a scientist by training. And she realized that the cosmetics that she was using, she felt didn't comply with the halal standard, the standard for which products that you consume should adhere to. So she has actually developed her own skincare products which comply with halal standards. And she's now marketing that not just to Muslim women, but any woman who feels that they want something that's organic and ethical. So I think her company is called Saf Skincare, Saf meaning pure. So I think that's really interesting. In the far side is the Desi Doll Company. So again, this was a Muslim woman who used to work in the city, had children, and decided when she had her children that there just weren't any toys that were suitable for Muslim children. And so her set up this company. This particular doll, when you press various bits of her, says various verses from the Quran. There's a male one, there's little toys in the shape of a masjid. Really lovely, spotted a niche, and produces very high quality toys. In the middle, again, I don't know if you've seen the explosion in Muslim swimwear. Suddenly, Muslim women up and down the country and around the world are saying, you know what, we want to go swimming, but we want a veil too. Where am I going to buy a swimsuit? And this particular one was the one that coined the phrase bikini, Have you heard of a burkini? Called Ahida. And I think its most famous proponent is one Nigella Lawson, who wore a burkini when she... Have you heard of Nigella Lawson? Sorry, I forget that we're not in London. I don't know if they covered it here, but she wore a burkini when she went to Bondi Beach, and this was splashed right all over all the UK newspapers because she's such a big celebrity and she trades on her curves. And it was very interesting reading the female columnists, and they're going, can't believe she's wearing this. This is terrible. You know, why is she covering up? She should be wearing a bikini. And then at the end, it's kind of like, oh, I wish I could wear one of those. Because there was a sense of relief, a sudden idea that maybe this modest Muslim fashion was something that we could embrace. And I think that's a really interesting intrusion into mainstream culture. And then just very quickly, the one with the red background is a woman in who got cancer and was worried that the products that she was using, the cosmetics, were giving her cancer again, developed her own halal cosmetics line with pure ingredients. And then, so I was talking about how Muslim women are being entrepreneurial and how they have more money to spend. So actually, big companies are starting to notice this. And that means, again, it's a different way to get the Muslim women's voice into the mainstream. And again, we think about, you know, getting the voice into politics or into the newspapers. But one of the parts of being in a society and being accepted is that, for example, this sounds flippant, but it's quite serious. When you go shopping, your shopping experience should be as enjoyable and as full as everybody else's. And we know that a culture has accepted its diversity when you can buy anything for everybody in the store. And so this is Sunsilk, which is obviously a really well-known shampoo brand. And they developed a shampoo for Muslim women who veil, because the needs of your hair when you veil are quite different from when you don't veil. And who'd have thought that? Sunsilk, obviously. How am I doing on time? I'm imagining.
Okay.
I'm okay?
Maybe 5 or 10 minutes.
Okay. So thinking, going along the idea of commerce, is another huge area of growth is fashion. And Muslim fashion is a hugely growing trend. And it's estimated by Bloomberg to be worth just shy of $100 billion. So it's a huge, huge amount of money. And what I find really interesting is that it's not just about Muslim women wanting to look glamorous and fashionable and stylish. I see in some of these trends, and if you look at the picture, it's about creating a new image for Muslim women away from some of the ones that we were looking at earlier. And in particular, in Muslim minority populations, you can see it as a political statement. This is who I am. I'm both West and East. I'm both Muslim and part of my wider society, and I'm proud of it. It's almost like a statement of empowerment. It's like, I can be all of these things and be me. And as I was saying, it brings this thread of being Muslim together. So just for your interest, Ala magazine is published in Turkey. It's the Muslim Cosmo. And it's very well known because in its first few months of sale, it outstripped Vogue and Elle. It was much more popular. And this is in a country, if you're familiar with Turkey, where the headscarf is extremely controversial. So they only feature models that wear the headscarf. Turkey is a secular country which doesn't allow the headscarf in public spaces. So this is quite an achievement. And Aqila is the one next to it. That's published out of Singapore. And that looks at the Asia region. Very, very high end, very glamorous, very quality. Again, looking at creating a new image. I don't know if you can see in that small one, it's quite stylish and very bold. The bottom two are actually two designers. So there's this crop of young Muslim female designers who basically said, there's nothing out there for me to wear that's both modest and funky. I'm going to go away and design my own clothes. So the bottom on the far one is Hannah Tejima, who's half English, half Japanese. And she has created her own line in the UK. And the one nearer me is an Indonesian couture designer called Dian Pelangi. And again, I think the way they kind of portray themselves is really quite interesting. So when we were talking earlier about voice not just being your audible voice, but how you portray yourself and the kind of your positioning and how that changes how people see you, I think these are some really good examples of how people are doing that. And you can see how, I mean, I imagine these hijabpreneurs are just a whole range of women who have embraced the internet as a way of creating businesses for themselves. And there was a study by the London College of Fashion which looked at how Muslim women, and Jewish and Christian women actually, are starting to use the internet to sell modest clothing because they felt they needed it, and the only way to create a viable business is to reach out globally so that there's enough custom for their products. So they found that the internet has actually opened up business opportunities for these women. And as somebody who buys them, it's quite good to have a bit of a choice. So that's some of the interesting things that Muslim women around the world are doing. And I'm hoping that they're not the usual ones that you see, and they're not the ones that you would normally come across. What I'm also really fascinated by is how Muslim women are altering the way we use language. These I think are quite fun. I like hijabilicious. That's just totally not what you would expect from a dull, dire story. Hijab chic, you know, this is kind of somebody who wants to be very cool. Fabulously halal. Again, halal makes you think of meat. This is something quite different. Alt Muslima is a website which is a forum for women or men to post stories about gender. So it's actually trying to create a space for women and men to talk. And then I quite liked, it's not specifically Muslim, but it's a woman who happens to run a site called the Eco-Muslim. And she leads a discussion around how you can quickly and easily be more eco-friendly in your day-to-day life, because that's what good Muslims should do, is what she says. She says that according to the Quran, every Muslim and every human being has a responsibility to be a steward of the world and the earth. And so she has this lovely little avatar. And I kind of talked a little bit about the internet and social media, so I won't talk about them too much. In the middle, Hijabers community is an Indonesian community set up specifically for women who want to veil and who want that sense of community support, which perhaps they can't find elsewhere. And they ran this really interesting campaign. They wanted 5 ambassadors for their eco initiative, and they asked their own members to submit their photos, and then they nominated them. I'm wondering whether to explain this chart to you or not. Okay, this chart is from the Dubai School of Government, and it's looking at how men and women in the Middle East use the internet. And the key thing to take away, because it's really tiny weeny writing, is that there's lots of things you can do with the internet, which is what's across the bottom, and they all do them, but the light orange bar is the women's one. And it shows that women are using the internet more than men because they don't have access to the actual physical spaces that men do. So for example, the first one is they use the internet and social media for entertainment and fun. And they're using this as a way to actually engage where they otherwise wouldn't have had the opportunity to do it. So it's been really, really important for them. So that's our little tour through some of the really amazing things that Muslim women are doing and how they're changing the narrative, not just for Muslim women, but hopefully for everybody. And I started off by talking about why it's important to have a voice and how you can express it. I run workshops on finding your voice, and many of them are targeted specifically, if I can actually use my voice, on Muslim women. Because women generally, as I've said, are very bad at coming forward and expressing themselves, and Muslim women in particular, I think, are a bit nervous for many of the reasons we looked at beforehand. So what are the kind of things that people say when we talk to them and say, you know, you have a voice, you have a really beautiful voice, you have a very interesting voice, you have something to say? They say, well, the first thing they say is, I have nothing to say. And this is what I would say, is that everyone has something important to say. And the proof for this is very simple. We all have a tongue. We all exist. We have ears. We have hearts. And they're there for a reason, and that's to use our voice. And what we overlook is people say, well, you know, I don't have any interesting stories, or, you know, I'm not educated, or I haven't been traveling, or I'm not a CEO. And what people overlook is the power of the personal story, and everybody has personal stories. And actually, one of the most engaging things is not being lectured at, it's actually to hear somebody's own experience. And the way to make that very engaging is to try and help the person you're engaging with to see what the insight is. What did you learn from that story? What did you learn? And the power of the personal story is it's not patronising, it's not condescending, it doesn't set you up on a pedestal. It just says, here's what I experienced, I give it to you to take from it what you will. And so everybody has something to say. Another objection is, well, I don't have anything to add. There's plenty of other people out there who are doing a really good job. Now, firstly, this is almost always not true. There are almost always not a lot of other people who are out there doing a good job. And this, the evidence of this is if you ever open a newspaper and you read a quote by somebody in a supposed position of authority, you just think, how did you get there? How did you say that? And so each of us, has something really important to say. And just because we are not in that position doesn't mean to say that we have something that's less valuable to say. And one of my favorite phrases is a statement by Salvador Dali, the Spanish artist. And he says, at the age of 6, I wanted to be a cook. At 7, I wanted to be Napoleon. And my ambition has been growing steadily ever since. What I wanted to be was Salvador Dali and nobody else. And for me, the takeaway is that each of us should want to grow into our own shoes because everybody else has already taken. This image, actually, just to reinforce the point of people who try and wiggle out of expressing their voices because they think somebody else is doing it. So we mentioned Femen earlier, and there were a number of Muslim women, including me, who got quite riled, and there was a campaign launched called Muslim and Pride, Muslim Women's Pride. And actually, this was a video put together, and you can see these are several Muslim women who just kind of got a placard and decided that they were going to protest. And actually, the beauty of this is that the more you have, the more power your campaign has. And so even if your individual voice you think won't be heard, it's really, really important. I'm nearly done. Okay. So then people say, well, I don't know how to say it. Okay, you've sold me. I want to express my voice. I don't know how. Well, this is where skill and training comes in. And I know that this lecture is at the end of the whole workshops of the Hijabi monologues, and there have been a lot of workshops. These are skills that can be acquired. And if you don't have them, go and get them. Because not only are they fantastic for activism, they're actually just really good in your own life to learn how better to express yourself and to engage with those around us. And actually, if you think about all the people you see on TV, standing on podiums, who've written on books, mostly, we just weren't very good, or we're not very good, to start with. Everybody has to practice. And the first 5, 10, 20, 50 times you do it, it's pretty miserable because you're going to do something that you regret. But it comes with experience. So just go out there and do it. Another complaint I get is, well, nobody's listening to anything I have to say. I've tried saying it. Well, one thing that you learn, for example, in corporate training is if you want anything to change, you have to tell somebody 7 times. So that's a pretty good benchmark. So it doesn't happen the first time. You need to keep repeating your message. And then finally, again, one I alluded to, people are very worried about what other people will say about them. Well, first thing is the world never changed by worrying about what others thought about us. And there's a lovely story which will draw my presentation towards its close, of a woman in Bangladesh last year who was at her wedding, her own wedding. And in Islamic tradition, the groom gives a dowry to the bride. But in cultural tradition, the bride's family must give gifts to the groom. So she got married to this fellow, and she says that 10 minutes after they got married, his family demanded a huge number of gifts. And on the spot, she told him that she was going to divorce him, which would have totally destroyed her reputation and her sister's and her family's. But amazingly, she said that she had to do it because she wanted people up and down the country to know what was happening. And if she didn't do it, then who was going to protect all the other women who were suffering the same fate? And interestingly, she became a national heroine. For having done something that people knew needed to be done, but nobody was brave enough to do. I'm getting looks that I need to finish. There's only 2 pictures left now. So a positive note, okay, something nice and positive to finish on. This is a campaign that's just begun in the UK this week for St. George's Day. So St. George is the English patron saint. his day was yesterday. And there's a campaign saying that the hijab should be as welcome as bangers and mash, which is a really nice way of expressing something about homeliness and togetherness. And a final one was a campaign in Norway, which was done as a Facebook campaign, and where women said, they were going to open, Muslim women said, we're going to open our doors and invite you in for a cup of tea into our homes. And I think, and that was very, very successful. So the neighbours came in and had a cup of tea with their next door neighbour or nearby neighbour Muslim women. And I think if anywhere I was going to stop and stop getting my serious looks, I need to finish, is to say that this is the kind of engagement that I think we need. So speaking out is really important. And I think, I'm hoping that there's enough food for thought here on some of the amazing things Muslim women are doing, really at the pioneering edge of changing our societies and cultures. But actually, sometimes just a simple cup of tea can be the answer. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Shelina. It was really fascinating, and I think packed with ideas for people to do things, very, very practical. And I hope we'll be able to see a copy of it. Maybe the British Council will publish it, or there may be some other plans. But I thought it was absolutely brilliant from the point of view of getting ideas for things that you can do, because sometimes people don't do things because they think they've got to do something huge. And as you say, sometimes a very small idea can be a really effective one. We're going to move on to the next part of the evening now, which is a panel discussion. So I'm going to ask Shelina to come back onto the panel, and she's going to be joined now by two really interesting Irish contributors to this sort of debate. Dr. Rocha Fazaeli is a lecturer in Islamic studies here in Trinity College. I'm sure that some of you know her work. She's a lecturer here in the Department of Near and Middle Eastern Studies. She's published numerous papers and book chapters on Islam and gender, Islamic feminism and human rights. She's a global affiliate of the School of Law at the University of Emory in the USA, and she serves on the editorial board of the Journal for Religion and Human Rights and on the executive board of Amnesty International Ireland. And before that, she served on the board of the Association of Persianite Studies, the Irish Refugee Council, and UNIFEM Ireland. So she's got a huge range of experience, and I know from hearing Rocha before, she's a really interesting speaker and full of ideas as well. And I'm also going to ask Denise Charlton to join us. Denise is the Chief Executive of the Immigrant Council of Ireland, which is one of the partners of this very interesting series of events. She's been in that role since 2003, and before that she was the Director of Women's Aid in Dublin. So she's got a very wide range of experience of working with women. In both roles, she's been involved in representation at local, national, and international level on social justice issues. And I know her in particular from her work on the Turn Off the Red Light campaign to end prostitution in Ireland. She's also been very prominent in campaigning against trafficking and on trying to stop violence against women in all the fields in which it appears. So two really interesting speakers to join, Shelina. So I think what I'll do first of all is maybe ask Rocha first of all to respond to what Shelina has said, and then give us some of your own thoughts, and then I'll ask Denise to do the same, and then we'll go back to Shelina, and then I'll bring in the rest of the audience. We are going to try to finish up not long after 7, maybe about 10 past 7, so we haven't got a huge amount of time. So Rocha, do you want to maybe start off?
I was quite struck actually. I use very similar stuff in my teaching. Mm-hmm. For example, I did a course on Islam in Europe, and in the first course I went and I looked on Google on Muslims, not Muslim women, and it was very similar, similar photos, so that was very interesting. And your thoughts about every woman having, or everyone having a voice, and Muslim women and women in general having a voice. That's very interesting. But one part that's very fascinating for me personally is when you gave example of the theologian like Amina Wadud, and because that's one thing that's really not heard in much within Muslim majority countries and outside, and there is a whole new scholarship on that. but again, not many people know about it. For example, in Iran, we've had female theologians that we did some research on it, but nobody actually knew about them in Iran. And even we went and interviewed people from home, very few people knew about it. And so that was the, you know, fascinating for me to hear you speaking about them. This was a wonderful finish to our Hijabi Monologue series as well, because when we had the Hijabi Monologues afterwards, it was very kind of obvious from what we got from the audience that there were still a lot of stereotypes out there. So a talk like this actually really helps to break down the stereotypes. And we need more of that in Ireland, because again, like I've said, those of you who heard me are probably sick of me saying this, you know, the Ireland, the Irish Muslim society is very different to other parts of Europe and the US, because one, it's new, and two, it's very diverse. It's your talk just translated so well into the Irish society. But that's all I'm going to say, because we don't have much time. Okay. Thank you again. Thank you.
Thanks, Roisin. It is really interesting that you've been working using similar types of material. And also interesting what you say about not, you know, people just not knowing about all this brilliant stuff that's out there. So maybe marketing is also, as you said, a very significant part of all this. Denise, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah, thank you for an amazing presentation. And as Roisin says, I think it's a brilliant end to the Hijabi Monologues, which I think people are aware, but is a project that was intended to give a platform to Muslim women and to share experiences. I was struck by a couple of things when you were talking. First is the kind of East-West, and Susan, you mentioned it as well. I work in the Immigrant Council, which is a migrant rights organisation, and so I work with people who have a lens that maybe started in Rwanda, moved through the Congo, is now living in Ireland, and has still got a foot in all of those places. And I see every day people who are navigating lives in Ireland, but who are also navigating some of their lives elsewhere, and how fantastic, and the contribution that makes. But also we see on an everyday basis a really restrictive migration system that doesn't recognise transnationality, that wants a centre of interest to be on the island, doesn't recognise and makes it very difficult for people to come and visit and go again. And so that's really kind of contrary, I think. The second thing I was really struck when we were talking earlier, when you were presenting earlier about kind of women generally, and I think the struggles or the challenges are very similar. I've been a feminist activist for more years than I care to disclose. And many of the struggles continue and are the same. And I was very struck when you were talking about the need for dialogue. Certainly for me, the Hijabi Monologues just has confirmed that the mix of women that participated are as different as any mix of women. And sometimes there's a massive advantage to that, but sometimes it's hard because we don't agree. And your disagreement might feel discriminatory to me or prejudice, and vice versa. And in some ways, where we have those conversations is very important, because you talked about the internal and the external lens that people have on them. And as a member of a minority myself, I understand that, the feeling of if you make a comment, you're deemed to represent all of those people. And that can be terrifying. And then the power of the voice. I work for a woman called Sister Stan, who people may know, and she's been a long-term advocate, and she all the time talks about the power of one and the voice, and she as an individual has achieved many things, but I think she really has taught me that about the power of one. And I was struck by just a milestone in my own life. I was at some very powerful meeting. I wasn't really sure why I was there, and as they went around the room and introduced themselves, I got more and more terrified. And I really was terrified. People were from the World Bank, from the UN. I made excuses during the breaks to go to the loo. I just was really absolutely terrified. And in a taxi from one place to another, what am I going to say to these people, these very high-profile men, actually. So in a very loud, squeaky voice, I said something like, have you been to this city before? And then this conversation started, and then I asked another one, what's your favourite city? And for me, that was a big milestone in my life, that actually people are very interested in each other, and we all have common issues that we can discuss. And then finally, I suppose, I just loved the images that you shared. So often, I think for women, there are stereotypes that we're tired of that are in the media all the time, and I have a particular interest in representation in the media. And so anytime that's challenged or changed or provoked, I love it. So thank you for that.
Thanks, Denise, and thanks, Rosha. Selina, do you want to say anything in response to?
I think I've said quite enough.
Okay, moving swiftly on.
Another thought. I like giving homework to my audiences. Mm-hmm. So based on what Denise was saying, a little experiment that I run when we do workshops, because understanding the value of your voice is really important, is I get people to complete this sentence, and you can do this in your own time. I am an expert in. And actually, you'll be surprised how many people just don't want to finish that sentence. But I guarantee you, when you go home and think about it, there will be something that you are an expert in, and you have credible evidence to show it. So that's more homework from me. I'm an expert.
Yeah, I think your idea, which both of the other speakers have taken up about everybody having an individual voice, is very important, because sometimes movements can really intimidate people, can't they? And you end up with people who have loud, confident voices claiming to speak for a lot of people who are actually only speaking for themselves, but it kind of silences other people who might actually quite significantly disagree with them.
I think what it's also worth noting is to have a voice doesn't mean to be on a platform.
Yeah.
To have a voice can literally mean sharing a really good idea with your best friend.
Yeah.
But it's being able to articulate your idea, because that's how things build. And I think people worry too much that they need a platform and they need to say a big thing, when actually small things are much more powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was recently interviewing a woman who was the wife of a very prominent person in the north, and she revealed that she had actually written significantly large portions of this book, for which he had become very well known. And she didn't mind at all that he was known as the author of it. She was just really happy that she knew very well that her bits were the best written bits in the book, and she was perfectly happy with that. I would like to bring in some of the audience now, because I'm sure that some of you would like to contribute to the discussion. We don't have a mic, so you might please raise your voices as much as you can, just to make sure that everybody can hear, because you're facing forwards and people behind you may not hear you. So, and if you like, tell us your name, and if you're in an organisation, tell us what organisation it is, or not, whatever you prefer. Yes.
Hi, I'm Priyanka. I'm a PhD student in politics and international relations in DCU, and I'm from India. It was a really good lecture. I mean, it's something I'm personally interested in, all the images you're showing of, you know, Muslim women redefining themselves. But I was more interested in I understand the stereotypes from the other, like the non-Muslim, but what about the acceptance of these women within the Muslim community, and in particular, you know, vis-a-vis other Muslim women? Like you talked about Amina Wadud, you're talking about these bloggers, many of whom I also follow, and you know, but sometimes you see the comments on some of these, or the responses of a lot of these Muslim women, in terms of trying to a large extent, you know, focus on religion, on how, you know, what their work is doing then is trying to dilute religion in some sense, or, you know, attacking them. It could be personal, it could be based on religion. So, I mean, how then would, you know, in terms of speaking out and in terms of voices, especially by Muslim women, for all these Muslim women who want to redefine themselves, who want to be part of this modern feminist wave, how do you respond to these, you know, the more conservative Muslim voices?
So that's a really good question, because I spent, as you say, most of the presentation talking about this kind of, I guess, a European, Western dynamic. But actually, there are huge challenges that Muslim women face within Muslim communities. And actually, in a way, that's the bigger challenge, because you still have to live and you still want a family and you still want to exist within that society. So I think you're right. A lot of women are creating change and they're speaking about it. And that means they're quite brave, and they're taking on the cutting edge. They are the pioneers in making that change. And I don't think there's any easy answer to say that it's smooth sailing. A great phrase somebody told me is, if you're not having problems, you're not having effects. So I think women realise that they're going to be creating change. I think it's a slow process, as any kind of social change is a slow process, so it's not going to change overnight, but there have been huge strides. One of the things I always enjoy is, for example, in my own experience, and I know this for other women, is because we get a public platform that's outside of the Muslim community, actually that starts to give you leverage within the Muslim community too. And so things that I now can, because of the support I give the Muslim community within a mainstream dialogue, for example, in my case, it gives me more leverage to talk about how society should change about Muslim women. And so I think there's a lot of Muslims who are active try and use that leverage to their benefit. But there are some really interesting things that people are doing. So in India, I think there was a declaration they would have a women's only mosque, because the mosques of men were not helping women, so they just created their own one, which I thought was fantastic. So slow, I did talk about how it's, you know, people are not listening, well, they do, but it takes time.
I think it's important as well to show solidarity to people when you agree with them, don't you?
Yeah.
People who do speak out bravely, because I'm sure Denise will be familiar with this. I mean, you know, I often find that people will come up to me and say, oh, I really liked what you said in such and such a programme, and some programme in which you've been savaged by other people on the panel or whatever. But unfortunately, those who are hostile to what you say are much more likely to speak out about their hostility. Isn't that true, Denise? And I don't know whether it's just this country.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think that thing of getting attacked, you do get thicker skin, mm-hmm. I think, as time goes on. But again, when I was thinking about this, the power of storytelling, and actually, Susie launched a book this week for a woman called Rachel Moran, and she's been telling her own story about being a former prostitute. Now, the bravery that it took mm-hmm. to do that, and she's told it brilliantly. But her reason for doing it is that she wants the law changed. She wants to see the demand for paid sex criminalised. And it's just such a brave thing to do. And I suppose throughout my work and Susan's work over the years, just working on gender-based violence, watching women share their testimony mm-hmm. and their stories incredibly bravely and really resulting in massive change and getting attacked, you know, and in particular communities, I've seen where women have been really worried about the internal world as well as the external world, but still done it and have made a massive difference. Like, it's mm-hmm. extraordinary. But I agree with that. I think the consensus voice often is very quiet. And so I think it's really important to also say to women, you're brilliant, you're fantastic. Thank you for doing that on our behalves, you know, because changes for women are good for all women, of course.
But as well as that, though, it is important that you need to remember, people are hearing you even if they don't speak out, you know. And I agree with you, Selina, when you say about Shelina, you say that sometimes it's just a conversation that you have. I mean, there may be somebody there who is really, really pleased that you've said what you've said, but they're not necessarily the person who's going to speak out. So, does anybody else like to say something at this point?
Can I just add?
Sure,
Oshin. Just a follow up about kind of, you know, the difference in context of Muslim majority countries versus where, you know, Europe and US and other countries where Muslims are the minority. And also kind of the difference between the states, talking about women's voices. I do a lot of activism within the Iranian women's movement, which has, you know, talking about voices, it has really been silenced especially since 2009. You have brilliant women like Nasreen Sotoudeh, who's a lawyer, a human rights lawyer, who is in prison and for long, you know, they're there for very long terms to get their voices silenced, or Bahara Hidayat, or Shiva Nazara Ahari. And these are, you know, women, they're Muslim women. But who all they were asking for, a lot of them, were, for example, changes in laws. Nasreen Sotoudeh, she was a defender. I have a lot of actually women's rights activists have been exiled in the last few years, and a lot of them actually have been defended by Nasrin, who's now in prison. She tried to make her voice heard even in prison. She was on hunger strike for a while, and you know, that's one way that the state is dealing with women's rights activists. Some of them are even Islamic feminists, Muslim feminists, but they're being silenced in the name of Islam, which is very interesting. but that's the difference in context. But you know, you have this campaign in Iran, the 1 million signatures to end legal discrimination, and because of the state basically oppression of the activists, it's we don't know how far it's gone. They were supposed to collect 1 million signatures to end legal discrimination against women and give it to the to the parliament. But in Morocco, on the other hand, there was the same campaign. The Iranian campaign was based on that. That actually worked, because it was sort of bottom up and top down. It went on for many, many years. But you know, you had the Mudawana in 2004, which legalized equalized the rights of men and women to a certain extent. So, like, you know, context is very, very important when we talk about voice, because there's also the authority that can silence the voice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, here it's probably more to do with people ridiculing women's voices, whereas, as you say, it can be very much more serious in other places. Anybody else like to join the conversation? Yes?
Yeah, I just want to thank you for this lecture. And I'm here by chance, and I'm so happy to join this group. And what I found very interesting from your talk was this necessity to create a sort of authorization for women voice. You know, we have to give ourselves this authority for a female voice, otherwise we remain in silent as always we have been, because before we had voice, but this voice was not recognized by women for starting. This is the situation all over the world. In art, for example, there are many women, many artists women, but on top there is no women. Mm-hmm. Because we have to give ourselves this authority. So thank you. This is our job, especially in literature and poetry. Thank you.
Thank you. It's nice to know that somebody just happened in upon this.
There's,
thank you.
I don't know. Sorry if you either want to say something. There's a couple of nice trends. You're right. We have to give ourselves permission, but we also have to normalise the female voice in the public sphere. And there's two really nice initiatives I've come across. In the UK, somebody has set up their own, because they were so fed up of, there was a case on the flagship BBC programme in the morning where there were four men discussing breast cancer. And they said, can't you find a female expert to talk about breast cancer? And from this was born her idea of called the Women's Room. And basically, if you're a female and you have an expertise, you sign up. And that means that any kind of media outlet has a roster of women that they can go to, which I think is a brilliant idea. And there was a similar one in the US where they found at Muslim events, there were no Muslim women on the platform. And when they asked the organizations why this was, they said, well, we can't find any Muslim women. And so they put together a list of 250 American Muslim women ready for organization. So I think you're right. We have to kind of provide the material.
Anybody else? Yes.
I find myself quite often in the position here of wanting to speak on behalf of Muslim women. My father is Muslim, I'm not Muslim, but a lot of people would know that and say my father is a Muslim. So people would often say to me, oh, Muslim women, they're all oppressed, and you know, a lot of, I kind of find a lot of women, Irish women or British women, feel that Muslim women will be free when they don't have to wear the hijab anymore. That's the impression that I get from a lot of women. What do I say to women when I get that kind of...
I think it's a really good question. I'd be interested to hear your views. I mean, I guess it depends on the specific question. I think humour is usually the best response. You know, I get asked, do I speak English? No. Why do I wear black all the time, I get asked. It depends on, I guess, whether you feel the person's genuinely trying to understand, and I think then you explain, and if they're just being difficult, then I would go with humour, but depends what works for you.
Well, you mentioned that in relation to when you were doing your book, and you were part of the motivation for writing the book was because you were fed up seeing sort of these stories about Muslim women which always seem to be sort of heartbroken women in black clothing sobbing and with camels in the background and, you know, looking completely miserable, and that there never seemed to be anything just about women leading ordinary lives.
I write in the book about, there's a whole section about the kind of questions that I get asked about wearing a headscarf, and I think they're similar for many Muslim women, and I would often get asked at work by male colleagues, surprisingly, what does your hair look like? And I'd just be thinking, well, if I wanted you to know, I wouldn't be wearing one, would I? So I would just say, well, I have a blonde Mohican. And they'd go, yes, you must have a blonde Mohican. And then they'd be like, are you sure about this? And then I go, I've got no hair at all. And they'd be like, oh, no hair. And then, you know, I think those are the kind of questions that you get a lot of. And for me, it's just kind of poking a little bit of fun at the fact that we're all a bit too serious about it.
Will that help? Try it. Rosha, would you like to say anything on that?
not much. It's again, like, you know, being an activist / academic, I tend to go back to my activism and things like this. For example, the 1 million signatures campaign that I gave the example of, actually hijab was not part of it. Because the activists, like, there are other campaigns to do with the headscarf as a choice, because it's enforced in the context of Iran, it's enforced. But the activists were saying, but we have all these other legal discriminations that we have to worry about. And at the end of the day, like, when I have the same conversations with friends, with the students, you know, with, again, random people coming up to me asking. And at the end of the day, it's a piece of clothing, and it can be very politically charged. And if you take the politics out of it, I don't think that questions will arise as much. And it's, you know, just have an honest conversation with them. Yes, it could be, you know, the other side of having the hijab, it could be oppressive if it's forced. Sometimes we forget to say that part, that if the choice is there, it could be very liberating.
Thanks, Denise.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I've learnt a lot from the hijabi monologues. The attempt was not to talk about the hijab, was to go beyond the hijab. And that was a real challenge, actually, because I think there's a genuine curiosity about it. And I think the message from the project was, as Roger was saying, it depends, it's contextualised, you know, it depends on where you're from, you know, what your attitude is, why, whether you've been forced to wear it or you haven't. But for me, the hijabi monologues was beyond that. It was about the experiences, some of the struggles, but a lot of the humour and a kind of courage and dignity that the women shared with us from around the country. But that one of the folk, trying to get away from the focus, it just kept coming back, every discussion, every debate. And I suppose, you know, very often it would be Raja answering the question in that way, and then it was moved on, actually. So I think genuinely people have been very interested, getting an answer that made sense and thought, okay, and then moving on to the rest of the debate and discussion. That certainly was my experience of the project and working with a diversity of women throughout it.
Okay, well, thanks everybody for coming. I think it's been a really, really good night. And before we finish up, I'd like to thank our speakers, Shelina, Rosha and Denise. Thank you very much for really, really interesting contributions. And I think people will do their homework very willingly. So thank you. And, you know, people should look online to find stuff by all of the three speakers here. There's plenty of it there, and some of the other names that you've mentioned as well, people can look up. Before we finish up, I just want to thank everybody who's made this evening possible, and indeed the other events in this very interesting series. I want to thank the British Council, first of all, for being the people who have organised the whole thing, and their partners then, the Immigrant Council of Ireland, Access Theatre in Ballymun, and that's all actually, isn't it? Oh no, in collaboration with the Muslim Sisters of Erin and other independent Muslim women's groups in this country. So thanks to everybody, and thanks to all of you for coming.